Views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
I'm blinded by your grace. I'm blinded by your grace, by your grace. I'm blinded by your grace. I'm blinded by your Lord, I've been broken. Although I'm not worthy, you fix me. I'm blinded by your grace. You came and saved me. Lord, I've been broken. Although I'm not worthy, fix me, now I'm blinded by your grace. You came and saved me.
One time for the Lord, and one time for the cause, and one round of applause, one time for Fraser T. Smith on the courts. I think we got one, I stay prayed up, then I get the job done. Yeah, I'm Abigail's youth, but I'm God's son. But I'm up now, look at what God's done. Nah, real talk, look at what God did. On the main stage, running around topless. My phone flips, then I tell him that we got this. This is God's plan, they can never stop this. Like, wait right there, could you stop my verse? You saved this kid and I'm not your first. It's not by blood and it's not by birth, but oh my God, what a God I serve.
Lord, I've been broken. Although I'm not worthy, you fix me. I'm blinded by your grace. You came and saved me. Lord, I've been broken. Although I'm not worthy, fix me, now I'm blinded by your grace. You came and saved me.
I said a prayer this morning. I prayed I would find a way to another day. I was so afraid till you came and saved. You came and saved me. And the rain was falling.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Good afternoon. My name is Kyle Quincy Parker, and I am your host on this lovely, lovely Sunday afternoon. It is the 15th of August, the year of our Lord, 2021. And today, I would like to spend a few minutes chatting with you about politics in the Bahamas and the views of the often courted, often quoted, but it's questionable whether they feel themselves to be often truly considered, those young people in our country who are either first or second-time voters, people who are under 30 or so, or in their early 30s and younger, and who are interested in the political arena, or, well, who could be persuaded to talk about it. Whether or not they're interested is, I think, part of the discussion today. We were gonna be joined today, and I hope to have her on the show on a future episode by Ashley Murray, who has a wonderful show called What You Think, and it's something that I encourage you to go find on Facebook and listen to the episodes. It's an eye-opener, and it is also very encouraging. And one of the most recent episodes of the show featured a group of young people being interviewed. And by young people, I mean people who ranged in age from 25 to 32, I think was the oldest. And they were asked a series of questions, I think it was about 10 of them. And the answers to those questions were, I thought, quite enlightening. And so that's kind of what I wanted to share a little bit with you as we are, you know, waiting for the Prime Minister to ring the bell, you know, as people are contemplating and calculating and, you know, reading pig intestines and casting the bones and looking at tea leaves and coffee grounds, trying to figure out exactly when Dr. Minnis is going to call the election. Amid the country still responding to a global health pandemic, and people on two of our major islands still struggling to recover from the effects of a major storm that did tremendous damage. I believe the number is still is about $3.5 billion with a B dollars in damage from Hurricane Dorian. And while the southern Bahamas still continues to rebuild in the aftermath of Joaquin and Michael, and while the world economy is sort of in the midst of a patchy resurgence, but there's still a sense of caution because of the pandemic. And so everything is just delicately balanced right now. You know, it could go, in terms of the world economy, it could go either way, right? And in the midst of all of that global uncertainty and all of that national I don't want to use the word calamity, but there's certainly some things other than party politics on our minds in the Bahamas at present. And into that mix, we now add the frenzy of a political season as people attempt to either get reelected to the House of Assembly or get elected to the House of Assembly for the first time. And the dynamics of that election are extraordinary. You have an incumbent party that came in on a wave, and that wave was so big that it saw the incumbent party win 35 out of 39 seats in the House of Assembly. And so with such an overwhelming mandate, it would have been incredibly simple for the governing party to have an agenda and simply march through its agenda with practically no parliamentary objections or obstruction. However, that is not what happened. And that didn't happen not because the four members of the opposition were so powerful an obstructionary force, but more because in the face of the twin blows of Dorian and the COVID pandemic, it became abundantly clear that with the exception of one or two ministers, the government at large did not really have an agenda. And as a result, forward motion has taken place in pockets in some ministries, and on some levels of governance, but the kind of get it done that you could have expected from a 35-4 majority has not been in evidence. On the other side of the coin, you have a party that has the legacy. You know, even PLP old members don't think of the PLP as a political party. They think of it as Glenys Hannah Martin, call it a movement. Some people call it a cult. You know, those people are not necessarily speaking in a positive term, but you know, there is definitely more than a party around the Progressive Liberal Party. And one would have thought that after suffering such a crushing defeat, it would have been a time of reflection for the party and perhaps either a return to original values, as Alfred Sears sort of represents in the PLP, or a reformation and transformation into something new and more relevant to the 21st century Bahamas that we live in. And I don't know many people who would say that the Progressive Liberal Party took the opportunity given to it by the Bahamian people to either return to its first love or to become something new and more attractive to the current voter. So what I see when I look at the current political directorate is really wasted opportunity. And then when you add the strongest other alternative to the mix, that being the Democratic National Alliance, there was an implosion there that sort of forces us to question, really, whether we as a country really want a third option. Because, you know, and I'm trying to get Ms. Komolafi to join me on the show to have this discussion, and hopefully she'll be able to join me one day in the not too distant future. But it's almost unfathomable to me that at a time when the whole country is dissatisfied with both of the traditional options, and let's not kid ourselves, folks, the whole country is dissatisfied with both of the traditional options. This should have been the DNA's time to shine. And instead, they dissolve into infighting and bickering in such a way that whatever positive momentum Ms. Komolafi had managed to generate seems to have just completely gone away. And what I thought was fascinating was that in the show, in Ashley's program, where the young people were asked very open-ended questions with no guide, you know, there were no guide words or no indications of what's the right answer. It was just very open questions. The DNA didn't come up a single time in the first part of the episode, in the first part of the show. I think it's in two parts, and I've seen the first part. I'm looking forward to seeing the second part, and perhaps the DNA gets mentioned in that, but they didn't get mentioned in the first part. And that is very telling to me, because it suggests that the main audience that one would have expected to be attracted to the DNA isn't even listening to them at this point. And that is not good for the old alliance there. That's a pretty bad rap. So when you add them to the mix, again, the phrase that comes up for me is wasted opportunity. And so if you want to consider this show in the context of what we're trying to achieve overall with the political review, which is, you know, to present a space where we can examine the national political directorate and this direction critically, objectively, with the basis of research, data, best practices, with a clean heart and honesty. And you would have to say that this presents an opportunity in this campaign, upcoming campaign, ongoing campaign, for somebody to step out from among the morass and occupy the ground that is now empty, where we are looking for leadership of thought and leadership in inspiration, and more importantly, leadership in terms of, don't just tell me what you plan to do in broad strokes, but convince me that you actually have an actionable plan to get there. When I read the FNM's 2017 manifesto, I found the document, on one hand, very useful, because if you look at it, it is very clear as to what the FNM intended to accomplish in regards to every one of the headings that were listed. And those headings were analogous to the government ministries that existed at the time. And there were, as I say, concrete deliverables listed that always made me wonder why people said there wasn't a plan when you look at the manifesto. The only weakness, and I think this might go to why people said there wasn't a plan, the only weakness I found in the document was that while it listed a number of deliverables, it did not list mechanisms to accomplish them, by and large. And I think that is what people are looking for. When I examined the Progressive Liberal Party's document, our plan, I suppose it was called, I found the same challenge. So, and when you looked at what the DNA produced, they produced an entirely different direction of deliverables. But again, there was an absence of, if we start here, the way we're going to end up over there is by going here and doing this. And I think that what is going to be most attractive to the young people of the country as they are listening to people who are out canvassing and attempting to convince them to spend their one vote is to use the words of one of the people who was interviewed by Ashley, a plan with some teeth, right? We want to see the five-year plan, you know, the young lady said. But we don't just want you to give us a plan. We want you to, we want to know how we're going to get there. So she was a 25-year-old person who had voted in the last election in 2017, was planning to vote in the upcoming election in 2022, if it is in 2022, and is looking to see not your high level deliverable, but your internal plan infrastructure, so that she can judge as a voter the strength of your plan, not on the idea of where you want to go. Because generally, I think we all have the same idea of where we want to go. That's what made the DNA kind of sexy, is because they wanted to go in a different direction. And, you know, at the beginning, who knows where they want to go now. But both the Progressive Liberal Party and the Free National Movement and the majority of the other people vying for election in the upcoming race. I mean, you got 8 ratified parties. You know, the majority of those 8 ratified parties, and I would dare say the majority of the independents who are running, all have the same general direction in which they are trying to go. So the destinations if the destination is the same, the real criteria on which to judge is the strength of your plan and how you're going to achieve it. And this 25-year-old young lady was very clear that is how she's going to cast her vote, on the basis of who has what she thinks is the best plan to achieve their 5-year agenda from day one to the last day of the term. And I think that's where I want to start in terms of discussing the views of the young people in this show, which for the purposes of this conversation, I'm going to take as indicative of the views of the larger set of young people in the Bahamas. Again, I'm talking about people who are between the ages of 25 and 31, 32, let's say as much as 35, right? In that 10-year slice between 25 and 35. And of course, if you have questions or comments and you want to join in, you can, you know the numbers to text us, and you can WhatsApp me as well. You can hit me up on Facebook. Put your questions in the comments on the post with Ashley and I'll read them, and we can have that discussion together. But the first point I want to bring to your attention as a wider audience, the question was, you know, what do you think about politics in the Bahamas in one word? And I would be curious to do a poll across the whole country to see what that one word would be if we were to consider to ask people to consider and define politics in the Bahamas in a single word. I picked three of those words that the guests on the show gave because they sort of represent the majority of what the young people on the show had to say. The first word is archaic. Now, I find this to be instructive because, we'll get to that. The next word is outdated. And the third word is excruciating. Exhausting, not excruciating. The third word is exhausting. My handwriting is that bad sometimes. And none of those descriptors, nor any of the other descriptors given in the question and answer period, were positive. These young people all believe, when asked, all stated that they believe that voting is vitally important. One of them went so far as to say, you know, you can't affect change if you're not a part of the voting bloc that is demanding the change. Particularly if you just sit outside the system and complain, you'll never get anything done. And so the view clearly from these from these young people, the view is very clearly that voting is important and participating in the electoral process isn't just a privilege or a right, but it's a responsibility and a tool that you can use to effect national change, which I thought was a wonderful and a very positive thing. But in terms of describing the politics that prevail surrounding the electoral process and the voting process, number one, archaic. Number two, outdated, which is a reflection of number one. And number three, exhausting. A fourth one that I was debating including, and I obviously have decided to include it, is repetitive. And that young person was referring to the fact that the two major parties simply continue to trade governance back and forth between them. And it is not clear to that young man what the difference is if the two can just keep trading power and the country just moves on, right? And I think that it's important to address that clearly And in my opinion, that is a reflection of the fact that, as I say, we all have more or less the same goals. The Bahamas is a natural tourism economy. So we naturally want to excel in our tourism offering. We are a country that has had an education revolution in the 50s and 60s. And so we naturally want to excel in our education system. We are a small country faced with the threat of constant illegal immigration. And so we all want to deal with illegal immigration and find ways to increase our national security, particularly at the borders. And we all want to live in a safe environment. And so we all want to deal with crime. And everyone has aspirations about their economic state in life. And so we all want a thriving economy, which allows us to not only make a living, but leave a legacy for our descendants. In the same way, well, in the way that legacies have been left for some of us. And so it's in broad strokes, we're all trying to get to the same place. And the difference between the two parties comes down to, number one, priorities, and number two, how they plan to get there. And that is a fundamental difference that I continue to believe is important, even as many of my fellow journalists continue to preach that there is no difference between the two gospel. I think that's wrong. I think there's a major difference between the two. And I think that difference is identified in how the parties intend to accomplish their agendas. There's a PLP way of doing things and there's an FNM way of doing things. And that's reality. And that is the difference. That is how you tell the difference. Now, when it comes to the nature of our politics as archaic, the young people there are hitting on something, right? Our system has not changed it has not changed tremendously since following majority rule, which was an earth-shaking change, and then the lowering of the voting age to 18, which was the second earth-shaking change, there really haven't been that many serious changes in how we do politics. In fact, and I think that regular listeners have heard me tell the story before, I read Henry Milton Taylor's first book, and he talks about politicking in Long Island in the 1940s, I think it was, and the system was simple. The party would identify the group would identify a house. That house would be stocked with food and rum, and a person from the government with a list of jobs would be brought into town, installed in that house, and the the job was you go to that house, you get your food, you get your rum, you sign up for a government job, and then you vote for the person who facilitated that practice. And the first time I read that book, it happened to be during political season, and I was driving down Faith Avenue when I saw a party headquarters where the rum, a party headquarters, where the constituency headquarters, where the rum was flowing like water. The music was pounding out into the streets, and people were mashing conch snack and fried chicken, and the grill was on fire. And I thought to myself that really nothing has changed. The way we campaign is more or less still the same. And yes, it is archaic. Is it outdated? It's only outdated if it doesn't work. As long as it works, it's current. Are there other ways of doing it? Perhaps. But are those other ways appropriate to our culture and our climate? Would they work for us? We'd have to try them to see, right? Is it exhausting? Yes. Yes, it is. Anyone involved in politics is already tired. And the bell ain't even ring yet. So, yes, young people, politics in the Bahamas is exhausting. And for you older folks involved in the game, you should be listening to what the young people are telling you. Archaic and outdated are not intended as positive descriptors of our national politics. When a young person says to you that something is old-fashioned or outdated, what they're telling you is that they don't see that thing as relevant to them or useful to them or connected to them in any real way. Which I think was supported to an extent by the answer to the question of whether or not the people who were interviewed for the show felt that young people are considered when policy is being made. So before we get to that, one more word on outdated. The person who said the politics in the Bahamas is outdated, when they were allowed to elaborate, talked about the education curriculum, which they said was was out an outdated education curriculum from the 90s, which is from the 1970s, excuse me, which is more or less, and they use the term Stone Age. The 1970s is Stone Age to a 25-year-old. Now, I happen to have been born in the early 1970s, so I had to take a moment when I heard that. I had to take a deep breath, realize that I am not an education curriculum, but I am a product of the early 1970s. So I suppose that means I'm Stone Age too, but my Lord. And the the reason that the young person in particular picked on the education system was, I think she's a teacher. And what she indicated was that students have the focus of that Stone Age outdated education curriculum is now not even on preparing students for college. It is simply preparing them to graduate from high school and nothing more. The advent of the graduation certificate and the leaving certificate, right, which requires a certain number of BJCs, if you're particularly precocious, you could take BJCs in grade 7. You take them from grade 7 through 9, and you still have students in the 12th grade trying to make sure they have enough BJCs so they can leave school. And to the young people involved in and interested in the politics of the country, that's a giant red flag and a serious problem. And I think they have pegged it correctly, in my view. That is a serious problem. But to go back to the part about whether or not the young people are considered, it was interesting because the answers ranged from, the answers all had a lot of nuance. And if I were to extrapolate an overall answer from what they said, and again, I encourage you to go and find the show and watch it. It's really, really good. But I, more importantly, I would rather that you come to your own conclusions about what the young people are saying, rather than, you know, just taking my word for it. But if I were to extrapolate, what I heard was that by and large, they believe that young people are considered as a matter of, or not as a matter, they're considered when it comes to certain policy directions more than others. You know, for instance, the small business policy thrust of the government, a couple of them brought that up and said, yes, that's a policy that considers young people. And there are some others that were mentioned that they thought didn't show a concern for consideration of young people. So the nuance there is that they believe some government policies more than others do consider young people. And I think that's a positive thing. Because it tells me that these young people do see themselves as not only the beneficiaries, but the targets of government action, government legislative action. And again, it comes down to, in the final analysis, is it effective? Well, that's not, you know, that wasn't the question. The question is whether you feel that government policy takes into account young people. And by and large, they seem to believe it does. I was surprised by that because of the number of Bahamian young people that I've heard say the Bahamas is not a real place. And I was pleasantly surprised because it tells me that even though there are significant numbers of Bahamians who say the Bahamas isn't a real place, at the very least, the young people who are interested in talking about the subject do believe that the political directorate, it considers them an important audience, an important constituency to cultivate and to make sure that they are considered as beneficiaries of government policymaking, which to me is absolutely true. If your policy does not affect your young people, your policy is almost useless, because it dies when people die. It should be institutional and systematic. But you know, I'm not here to, that's not my place. The next thing that I wanted to point out was the question, I'm picking things that have come out in the national discussion about young people, particularly on things like these talk shows and some of the TV chat shows and whatnot, and in works of opinion. You know, and the prevailing opinion seems to be that young people are not interested in voting, or don't think it's important to vote. But every single person on the show who was asked a question, and that's all of them, said that voting was incredibly important. And as I said, there was the one young man that elaborated, talked about how important it is to be involved, because, and his example was, if you have a problem with the way that the national finances are being apportioned, then you find a party or a candidate whose views align with your own, and you empower that party or that candidate with your vote. And in that way, you are applying pressure on the national stage to try and accomplish something that as an individual you could not accomplish without the power of the vote. And I think that, I mean, that's a perfect example. And so I thought it was, again, very encouraging that that these young people, who again, until I'm told otherwise, I'm going to take as a good cross-section of the country's young people and say that they speak for the majority. And I mean, I say it with a grain of salt, obviously, but they do believe that voting is important. And for those people who are campaigning, who are going from house to house, seeking votes, there's, I think, always the temptation to say, you know, is your mommy at home, or is your daddy at home, or your parents here? Let me talk to the adults in the house. And I think that there is a very strong risk when we do that we are missing an opportunity to sell our program directly to the people who are going to have the longer voting record, right? They're going to be able to vote in one or two more elections than the people who are ahead of them from now. So it's in our interest as a nation practicing politics to stop thinking of politics as adult business and start thinking of politics as national business, and recognizing that, you know, the 18-year-old who can vote is every bit as much an educated and discerning voter as the 56-year-old, and each one of their votes carries the same weight. And I think that's vitally important that we recognize. So the next the next thing that they talked about, which I thought was really great, is what fact. Oh, okay. Sure. So we're going to take a break, and then when we come back, we'll get to that next factor in just a short while. We'll be right back. You fix me, now I'm blinded by your grace. You came and saved me.
One time for the Lord, and one time for the cause, and one round of applause, one time for Fraser T. Smith on the courts. I think we got one. I stay prayed up, then I get the job done.
Enjoy an elevated mobile experience with BTC giving you
unlimited talk for the best conversations,
unlimited data for all your online fun,
and unlimited roaming to stay connected while overseas
for just $50 per line.
Unlock unlimited mobile talk, data, and roaming when you sign up for BTC Superfast Fiber Internet with speed starting at 100 megabits per second. Enjoy more great savings and value. Upgrade or sign up today. Visit any BTC store or btcbahamas.com. Conditions apply.
Always on the go? Missed the show? You can now listen to Guardian Radio talk shows anytime, anywhere on Spotify and YouTube by searching Guardian Radio 96.9 FM or by entering the name of your favorite show. You can also listen by logging on to guardiantalkradio.com and clicking on the podcast tab. Guardian Radio, continuing to provide you with fresh news and smart talk anywhere, anytime, all day.
There comes a time when the game tolerates no spectators, only players. There comes a time when we must recognize that our individual aspirations shape our collective destiny. There comes a time when getting in the game, despite the risks, despite the challenges, regardless of the cost, is simply the right thing to do. There comes a time when we must find our hearts, find our soul, and pursue our purpose for the greater good of all, for country, for humanity. There comes a time when we must manifest our true greatness. Yes, there comes a time, and that time is now. So let's get down to the essentials. The essentials. Serious radio for serious people committed to advancing the national conversation.
The Essentials with Hubert Edwards, Thursday nights live at 6:30 p.m. to 8 p.m. on Guardian Radio 96.9. Morning blend business.
The economy.
Finance. Business.
Industry.
Government sector. Private sector.
Financial services.
Tourism.
Personal finance.
Investing advice.
Consumer issues. Consumer rights.
Trends and business opportunities.
Morning blend business. Following morning blend every weekday from 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. right here on Guardian Radio 96.9.
Are you interested in the Bahamian economy? How about tips to improve your financial literacy? Tune into Guardian Radio's newest financial podcast series, C-File Talks. The podcast will provide listeners with their weekly dose of economic issues and solutions and the keys to financial freedom. C-File Talks will be hosted by an array of finance experts here to give honest and beneficial advice. You won't want to miss the C-File Talks podcast series, Monday evenings from 6:30 to 7 p.m. here on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM.
Track and field is the queen of the Olympic Games.
In its seventh season, Track World with Alpheus Phillipson, the only radio show in the Bahamas and one of the few in the world dedicated to our beloved sport, continues to promote the athletes, coaches, officials, leadership, and the partners who make a difference in our sport.
We encourage you to tune in to Track World on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM each Tuesday evening on cable channel 969, on Guardian Radio's website www.guardiantalkradio.com, or streaming live on Facebook at 6:30 and be dazzled.
Concerned about your health? Have a health question that you're curious about? Ask the doctor. The Doctor is In with me, Dr. Denothra Archer Cartwright. We're talking health, wellness, and all things that pertain to the Bahamian society and the health of the nation. Tune in Tuesday nights at 7:30 p.m. to 9 p.m. The Doctor is In on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM.
Hi, I'm Amanda Coulson. I'm your host on the NAGB's Blank Canvas, the show in which we speak about visual culture and creative community. Blank Canvas airs every Wednesday night at 6:30 on Guardian Talk Radio 96.9. On Blank Canvas, we meet cultural practitioners from the creative community here in Nassau, Bahamas, and also internationally, Bahamians from all around the world doing amazing things in the cultural scene. Tune in to NAGB's Blank Canvas to hear about what's happening at your institution and around the Bahamas every Wednesday night at 6:30 on Guardian Talk Radio 96.9.
There comes a time when the game tolerates no spectators, only players. There comes a time when we must recognize that our individual aspirations shape our collective destiny. There comes a time when getting in the game, despite the risks, despite the challenges, regardless of the cost, is simply the right thing to do. There comes a time when we must find our hearts, find our soul and pursue our purpose for the greater good of all, for country, for humanity. There comes a time when we must manifest our true greatness. Yes, there comes a time, and that time is now. So let's get down to the essentials. The essentials. Serious radio for serious people committed to advancing the national conversation.
The Essentials with Hubert Edwards, Thursday nights live at 6:30 p.m. to 8 p.m. on Guardian Radio 96.9.
This is your host, Valentino Brown, inside the inner city. Join us as we continue to tell our stories, challenges, talk about the history, and share our hopes and dreams. Tune into Inside the Inner City on Fridays at 6:30 p.m. on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. And remember, the place in which I fit will not exist until I make it.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Fix me, I'm blinded by your grace. You came and saved me. Lord, I've been broken. Although I'm not worthy, you fix me. Now I'm blinded by your grace. You came and saved me.
One time for the Lord, and one time for the cause, and one round of applause, one time for Fraser T. Smith from the courts. I think we got one. I stay prayed up, then I get the job done. Yeah, I'm Abigail's youth, but I'm God's son. But I'm up now, look at what God's done. No, I'm real tall, look at what God did. On the main stage, running around topless. My phone flips, then I tell him that we got this.
Yes, I stay prayed up, then I get the job done. I'm Josephine's youth, but I'm God's son. Believe that, my brother. All right, folks. Welcome back to the Political Review. That's Stormzy, one of my favorites, and I encourage you to listen to his catalog. He's quite good. The show today has been dedicated to the to a conversation with young people. I had intended to have as a guest Ms. Ashley Murray, who's the host of a show called What You Think. And it is an internet, I'm going to call it a new internet sensation. And I encourage you to go to Facebook and look the show up and check it out. It's really, really good. She was unable to join me today. She had to pull out. And as a result, I have decided to talk with you about some of the things that were on one of her recent shows, which was a show featuring sort of the young people, a cross-section of about a dozen young people who were discussing or being asked questions about politics in the Bahamas. And it was a fascinating episode. I thought it was really good. And I came to the conclusion that the overall rap that we give young Bahamians, that they are disinterested in politics, et cetera, is outdated. You know, I don't think that's true anymore. I'm not saying that this show changed my mind. I'm saying that this show confirmed a change of mind that I've experienced a while ago. And as a, listen, I'm sorry, this still tickles me, right? But one of the young people, I think she's a teacher, she's 25, talked about the fact that our education curriculum from the 1970s is stone age. I was born in 1972, y'all. So that made the gal call me stone age. I feel a way. I feel a way. Kermit the gal called me stone age, but anyway, I'm over it now. Well, no, I lie. I'm not over it, but I'm going to pretend that I'm over it. I'm just going to move on. But in any event, I think that that is indicative of, I think, both a weakness and a strength for young people who are connected to politics, to think of something from 1970s as Stone Age means there's a level of disconnect between that which happened in the 1970s and that which is happening now in the 2010s, or 20-teens, I guess you'd call them. And that's a problem, because what's happening now is a reflection of the outgrowth and effect of what was put in place then, what was envisioned at the time. And it could be argued that their vision in the 1970s is being played out now in 2021. Lord have mercy, it's the 2020s. Where is time going? What kind of nonsense? Anyway, yes, that might be Stone Age, but it's still important. And I think that that's a part of the disconnect in the conversation as well, is that young people constantly looking forward seem to be only too willing to let go of the past and to dismiss the past as not important anymore, and not relevant anymore, and not having any effect anymore on the present. And the truth couldn't be any different. The past is prologue. The past is the future, especially if you don't learn from it. The past is your foundation. The past is where everything that made you began. And the most important thing you can do is know your past. Know it intimately. Know it with great exactitude and detail. Because otherwise, anyone could tell you who you are, and you can't tell them they're wrong, because you don't know. So this is one area in which I think young Bahamians, particularly those interested in the political directorate, need to perhaps have a different, or at least continue the debate about whether or not the past is important. And the use of the term Stone Age, I mean, it might have been an emotional moment for her, but, you know, it's emotional for me too. So anyway, so before the break, I mentioned that the last thing that they talked about that I wanted to mention, and they talked about a good number of things. In fact, I'm going to see if I can put up a link to that show so that you can have a peek at it yourself on my Facebook page. But yeah, what you think? Awesomeness. Good. But the the question was asked, what features, I'm sorry, what factors will you as a young person consider in the upcoming election? And of course, you know, that's a tremendously important question. And the answers range from to, and the first one is vision. And I found that very interesting. This is, so I'm posting a link to the show on my Facebook page. So you can hit me up on Facebook at either the Political Review or my personal Facebook page. And the link will be there. And it's up now. All right, yeah. So the first answer that they gave, the young person gave, was vision. And I thought that that was fascinating as a response to the question, you know, what factors you would consider in the election, because it suggests that there are some things that the young people in our country feel are lacking that leaves a space for someone to occupy. If a person says, if a person says that they want to, they're going to be considering vision, my belief is that that means that person wants to be inspired. I think they want to see or hear something that arrests their imagination, something that makes them go, something that they can say, that's what I want. And that's, to me, very positive, because it allows for your it allows for your conversation as a political candidate, I suppose, with young people, to have as much to do with the way you see the world and the way you see them and what you see as important. And while we're talking, you know, and we'll get to the young lady who talked about the five-year plan, but there's always room for someone who can articulate a compelling vision. And that's not just something that young people are interested in. I think we are all interested in someone who can give us a vision that we can all support, share, find compelling, commit to, you know, show me something, whether that's an individual situation or whether that's a vision that, you know, the party, excuse me, that the party is committed to. Show me how you see this whole thing playing out. What's your grand idea? What's the big scheme? What is it that you're committed to? And then the next thing they talked about was policies. And I think these things all work wonderfully well together, right? After you've showed me your vision and tell me the policies that you are going to promulgate and enforce that are going to bring that vision out of the realm of your imagination and into reality. You know, tell me what policies are going to underpin you bringing that vision to life. A great example of this, you know, and in the early days of the Minnis administration, then Deputy Prime Minister Peter Turnquest talked about this vision that he and the Prime Minister had for empowering small businesses in the country. And as the Minister of Finance, you know, he elucidated a very clear vision for how they would, or for what they wanted to do, which was, you know, allow micro, small, and medium enterprises, that's basically any business with fewer than 50 employees and less than $5 million in annual turnover, to have access to all of these tools that would allow them to succeed and to grow and to become powerful and sustainable and have business continuity, right? And then the government wrote some policies and brought those policies into action to support this vision of empowering entrepreneurs. And what the result of that was the founding of the Access Accelerator Small Business Development Center. And now the next step is there's legislation being drafted and circulated to establish that agency in law. So now it goes from just vision to you have your policy. And now the young lady who is saying the factor that she's going to consider is a 5-year plan. So now you have an actual concrete, on a certain day or by a certain time, we will have accomplished XYZ set of steps. Those steps will allow us to plant a flag here and so on and so forth. And I think that it's going to be very hard to canvas, but I use the SBDC, the Access Accelerator SBDC, as an example of something that went from vision to policy to a part of the 5-year plan. And I think that those three factors all sort of correlate to the last factor that was mentioned. Well, not the last factor, but the last one I'm going to quote for the purposes of the show today, which is leadership. Right? So you have these young people contemplating what it is they're going to be looking for in the upcoming election. One of them wants to see vision. So you can't go around to young people without being able to articulate to them where you want to take them, what it is that you want to do on the grand scheme. What's your grand big idea? Why are you doing this? What is the point of your running for office? Why do you want to be in government? Right? And then they're looking for policy. They want to know, okay, a vision is great, a grand idea is good, but what are the components that make up your policy directives? What are you going to do that is going to serve as marching orders for the government infrastructure and for the political directorate underneath you once you're in government to begin to act in a certain way and to begin to do certain things to produce your vision as a result of their actions, right? Another policy initiative of the Minister administration might be the decision made by the Prime Minister to, or the Minister of Works, for instance, to defer to allow or to have the different utilities defer payments or defer customer payments for a period of time during the COVID pandemic, right? That was a policy decision, and it allowed them to make a statement about how they wanted to continue to work to support the average Bahamian and also to support the average business. Because of course businesses are struggling as much as individuals are with this pandemic and all of the restrictions that it has caused and imposed. And so after policies, the young people want to see your plans, but they don't want to see anything that is nebulous. They want to see concrete, detailed plans that last throughout the term. They don't want to see a plan for the next 3 months. They want to see a plan for 5 years. And why is that? They want to know that you're not just going to run out of steam in 3 months because you've reached the end of the road that you plotted for yourself. You're now successfully ensconced in the House of Assembly, and all you're going to do is just sit there and waste time. No, they believe, and this, ladies and gentlemen, this is what's so sexy about this, right? Is that these young people believe in their souls, in their bones, that if you get into politics and if you get into the House of Assembly, you can actually change things. They believe that if you get into politics and if you get into the House of Assembly, you can actually make a difference in people's lives. You can actually help people. You can help people to get better access to healthcare. You can help people to get better results from the education system. You can help people live safer lives through crime reduction. You can help people get into business and succeed by tweaking the economy in any one of a million different ways. They believe that you can get into power and make a positive difference in people's lives. And that, ladies and gentlemen, more than anything, is the sexy thing. So to get back to your five-year plan, they're not interested in what you're going to do in the next month or two. They want to know that 4 years in, you still have things that you are trying to get done. You still have deliverables for which you are answerable to your constituents. You are still working on day 5 years minus one as hard as you were working on day 5 year plus one. Right? So it's, to me, it's really encouraging to have that level of intellectual passion focused on national politics. And another factor they say they'll be considering in the upcoming election is leadership. Now, this one to me is fascinating because leadership is such a nebulous term. What does it mean? When you say leadership, what are you talking about? Right? I mean, aside from simply the act of leading a group of people or an organization, or the position of being a leader, when you think about leadership, what is it that these young people are trying to say? What are they looking for? And I started thinking about this, so I started looking at different definitions of leadership. I want to share some of them with you before we take off. Kermit, I'm probably going to wrap up at about 5:30. My voice is a little tired, and so since we didn't have a guest today, I think I'm going to pull the plug around there. And I want to go out with that song that I put in the chat, by the way. The first thing that I want to share with you is this idea of seven definitions of leadership. This is not profound, but I thought that in the context of the conversation that we are having today, I thought that it would be good to read these and consider how they might apply. and I'll read the definition, and I'll leave it to you to determine whether this is what you see in the current political directorate, or in the people who are seeking your vote, the people who've come to you so far and said, "Vote for me." One, Napoleon Bonaparte said this: "A leader is a dealer in hope." And so the first, definition of a leader is that leaders motivate. That is to say, leadership is the art of motivating the actions of others. Most definitions of leadership include some aspect of motivation. They inspire people and teams to action. Next, leaders make decisions. They set clear direction and take responsibility for decisions, especially in the face of uncertainty. The next thing is leaders coach. And here it's the quote John D. Rockefeller, who said, good leadership consists of showing average people how to do the work of superior people. I love that. I really do. And the definition of leadership here is that leaders are knowledgeable individuals who share wisdom with individuals and groups. I hope you're hearing and finding these things useful. Max Lucado, one of my absolute favorite writers, has this beautiful quote that I think is appropriate here. says, a man who wants to lead the orchestra must turn his back on the crowd. I'm going to read that one again. A man who wants to lead the orchestra must turn his back on the crowd. And for this, its leaders are confident. They have confidence in themselves and don't seek to please everyone. And this confidence attracts followers. And so the definition of leadership here is leadership is an ability to exude confidence and attract followers. Next, Lao Tzu is one of the, you know, one of these wonderful Chinese mystics and philosophers whose work is, you know, fundamental in shaping not only Eastern thought, but a lot of Western thought as well. One of the great, I think, Buddhist and Hindu sages. And he said, a leader is best when people barely know he exists. When his work is done, his aim fulfilled, they will say, we did it ourselves. And so this one is about leaders' influence, right? And I'm going to read what is said here, where I kind of found these quotes. But the biggest leadership myth is that leadership extends from authority. Many leaders gain formal authority. However, it's not possible to lead with power alone. You can force people to comply with authority. However, you can't win their hearts and minds with power. For that, you need influence. And so under this rubric, they define leadership as the ability to influence thoughts and actions. Obviously, Steve Jobs was a great leader. The quote from him is, innovation distinguishes between a leader and a follower. And so obviously here he is quoted as saying, leaders innovate. And innovation is a sort of a tricky word. It's kind of defined as the elusive ability to create something new and of value, right? It's the basis for economic progress, and a crucial leadership ability. Innovation is not just creating something new. It has to be new and useful. And that's, you know, I think about where we are right now in the world, right? You look at the COVID-19 pandemic and you consider how quickly the vaccines were developed. And what many people still don't realize is that those vaccines were developed so quickly because they were built using technology that was innovated as early as 2003. This RNA mapping to create antidotes viruses vaccines against viruses. And in 2003, the research that underpins the COVID-19 viruses was published. And that's innovation, when you create something new that can turn around and be used in a way that benefits other people. And that's leadership, the ability to create innovation. And finally, I think it comes down to this, right? Leadership is about getting results. So leadership is just the demonstrated ability to innovate, make decisions, influence and motivate other people and get them to achieve results. That's the kind of thing the young people of the Bahamas are going to be looking for when, you know, people are going door to door and trying to ask for their votes. And I think that the political directorate would be very wise to pay attention to what the young people are saying, right? They are not, kidding. And one of the things that they constantly say is that, quote unquote, older folks sometimes don't listen. And as somebody who was born in the Stone Age, a young 25-year-old, I think it is interesting, I to listen to young people and hear what they are saying about something as vital and important as politics in the 242. So I think that we should be very proud of our young people, but we should also take them seriously. Right? Sometimes when we rush to be proud of people, we pat them on the head and say, "Oh, good boy, good girl," as if that means something. I mean, you know, to a 3-year-old, good boy and good girl means a lot. But to a 25-year-old, what is more important than you telling them what a wonderful person they are is listening to what they have to say. And then more than listening, taking that into account and making decisions that reflect the influence of their input. And I think that is how we move forward as a country together. And that is how our political leadership can benefit from the influence of young people in the country. I really look forward to having this conversation with Ashley when she's available. And I really wish she could have been here today. She had agreed, as I said, and so I wanted to make it clear for the folks who saw me put it up on Facebook and Twitter. She realized she had something else and she couldn't come. So she didn't just back out. She'll come another time. And until then, you know, it's you know, we'll have that conversation. So that's going to do it for me today. Kermit, you're a superstar as usual. And next week, we'll be back with a full 2-hour show. And we thank you for your time and energy. In the meantime, in the week ahead, find some young people and talk to them seriously about politics in the Bahamas. Listen to what they say, and you might learn a thing or two. Until next week, God bless, and we'll see you then. That's me. I'm out. Okay. Apparently, I'm not out. I guess it's just my producer is momentarily distracted, but that's fine. So at the risk of overdoing it, there you go. So we'll see you guys next week. God bless.
You need a song to perform the surgery that will heal every part.
We need a song
to kill diseases just like the one.